No teenagers today, right? So here we go. All right, 1 Timothy chapter 3. In 1 Timothy chapter 3, we've been going through talking about some things, specifically dealing with the church and rule. And of course, we talked about 1 Timothy. That's the issue there in 1 Timothy chapter 3, are the issues of this office of a bishop. Then he gets into the office of a deacons, starting off in verse 8. Then he concludes chapter 3 with the whole church, the body of Christ, specifically in the local assembly. And it's really interesting because then he goes into chapter 4, which is some really interesting things once we get there. But what I want us to do today is we're going to start reading verse 1. We'll read down through verse 7, and we'll see how far we can get done today. So this is a true saying: if a man desire the office of a bishop, he desireth a good work. A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior, given to hospitality, apt to teach, not given to wine, no striker, not greedy of filthy lucre, but patient, not a brawler, not covetous, one that ruleth well his own house, having his children in subjection with all gravity. For if a man know not how to rule his own house, how shall he take care of the church of God? Not a novice, lest being lifted up with pride he fall into the condemnation of the devil. Moreover, he must have a good report of them which are without, lest he fall into reproach and the snare of the devil. Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we have to study your word. And as we take a look at these qualifications, may we allow to examine ourselves and take a look at where we might be able to fit in within the church itself, that we all might be able to be to the praise and honor and glory of your grace. And it's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. Now, as we've gone through here, the first couple issues that we've noticed is the bishop must be blameless, the husband of one wife, and that's what we've dealt with so far. And the idea there is the only way that you're blameless is because you're in Christ. And of course, that's the issue of putting on display who you are. And one of the things that we've said before is it possible for you to be able to put on display something that you don't know who you are? And that's really hard to do, because If I'm supposed to, as a math teacher, I'm not going to go in and start teaching social studies in my math class, because that's not who I am, right? And if I know who I'm supposed to be, then I can actually live in a way that would be pleasing to the Father, because I am putting on who he says that I am. This issue of being blameless, we've talked about that issue before. It's without blame. And we've taken a look at the verses that talk about us being holy and without spot and without blemish and all those things. This is true about every person that's in the church, the body of Christ. You are blameless. And if there's nothing else that we can get, is that very first part there, as far as blameless, each and every one of us match that because of who we are in Christ. Now, are we putting that on display? That's a different story, right? And the idea here is, when you think about these, and as you go through this, you'll see some issues. Notice, just drop down to verse 6. Well, those first three words, not a novice. In order to be a bishop, what's one thing that you shouldn't be? Brand new to it. Well, I just got saved, or I just learned right division. I want to go and preach. Most churches today, we've mentioned before, is they do what? Win them, work them, and whip them. As soon as you get saved, we're going to dunk you, and then we're going to put you in charge of some Sunday school teaching. That's what a lot of places do. And what happens is you put a novice in a position of a teaching, of that of a teacher. What happens is they're going to do what? Lest being lifted up with pride, he fall in condemnation of the devil. What's the end result of that? If you're a novice, what's the end result of it? That's going to be the end result. I've seen over and over and over again throughout the years. We had a guy years ago on Pal Talk. He was teaching, and I was very much against this particular person for teaching on Pal Talk, because he was not ready. He'd been crowned the next young man's going to be right division preacher and blah, 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 this, that, and the other by social media and some other folks. And you talk to the guy and you find out this kid's a novice. Well, what happens to this kid is within a few months, he ends up becoming he ends up falling into, trying to think how he did this. It doesn't matter how he did it. But he ends up falling into evolution. And then he ends up in denying Paul's an apostle. Then he ends up denying the Bible itself. Why? Because he was a novice and somebody put him in a position to teach and he was not ready. What happened? He was lifted up with pride and he fallen in condemnation of the devil. What can the devil... What? We mentioned before, there's two main issues. Satan wants you to get you to change the message. He's going to get you to change the message, or he's going to come after you as the messenger to do what? To discredit you, or to get you to the point where you're just like, well, I don't know if I should be doing this at all. That's what he's going to do. That's it. That's how he's going to go about doing things. In this particular way, what happens is what? He ends up high-minded, conceited, believing the stories that, hey, I'm the next big guy. And that's a shame, because what could have happened is he could have been a really good teacher, but he wasn't ready yet. And somebody said, well, we're going to have you teach. And just with conversations that I had with him, he wasn't ready. But I wasn't the one running it, so he ended up doing it. Well, what happened is he fell away from the message. And he's just one example of many that I know of. I've been saved for 26 years. And there was a time early on when I was like, man, I just want to teach this message. And it got to the point I told myself, you need to shut up and study. Study to be quiet. Because I was just saying stuff that I'd heard, and I didn't actually study things out. And it got to the point, and that's one of the reasons why I say now, just because you've got a camera and a Bible doesn't mean you should use them at the same time. Especially if you don't have a local assembly to be accountable to. Do you know how easy it is to not be accountable to anybody and just teach whatever you want to? Because there's a lot of that going on. I know a lot of guys that does not have a local assembly, that they're not accountable to anything that they teach, and they're teaching all kinds of crazy stuff, and they don't have anybody come along saying, you don't need to be teaching. Sit down and listen. Sometimes we need to do that for ourselves. In fact, if you go over to 2 Timothy chapter 2, the whole issue with that is, notice here in 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22. This is towards the end of we're about halfway through 2 Timothy here, but notice 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22. Paul's writing to Timothy. Notice he says, flee also youthful lusts, but follow righteousness, faith, charity, peace, with them that call on the name of the Lord out of a pure heart. But foolish and unlearned questions avoid, knowing that they do gender strifes. And the Lord of the servant must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach. Now, wasn't that one of the things in the list that we read over in 1 Timothy chapter 3? Is apt to teach. Having the ability to teach. At the drop of a hat, you're able to, at any moment, you should be able to teach something. If you're not, then you're not apt to teach. Now, that's something else we'll get into, a whole other thing with that. But patient. Notice, in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. Now, notice, in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves. What's it mean to oppose yourself? If you're complete in Christ and somebody comes along and says, you're not complete in Christ, here's some things you need to do to become complete in Christ, what should you do? Faith says, I'm complete in Christ, I don't need to go do those things. Living based off of not by faith, but by the flesh would say, well, I need to go do those things. And you go and you operate in those things, what are you doing? You're opposing who you are. You're saying, I'm not complete. I need to go do these things over here to become complete. And he's saying what? You oppose yourself. Notice, if God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth and that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil. Who's supposed to recover you out of the snare of the devil? Yourself. You should be able to do that. You should, and not like, I didn't know that at the time, and I was just putting stuff out, and I'll go back and listen to some of those things, and I was like, I shouldn't have been putting stuff out. But I learned. And that's one of those points that we need to be able to think about. But here's the issue is what? And that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. So when we're over here in 1 Timothy chapter 3, and he talks about this issue of not a novice, and like I said, we'll talk about that a little bit more once we get there. That's that issue of if we can't look at our own lives and say, I'm not ready, then we're probably still a novice. If we can't recognize it, if we can't recognize that we're not ready, then we should realize we're novices. Right? And what I've learned throughout the years is if you're a novice on something, probably best not to talk about it. Right? Now, that was kind of a in the middle advertisement for verse 6, but back up to verse 2. Right? Again, we're talking about this position of bishop, and Paul's laying out qualifications for this particular office. Verse 2, a bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife. And we talked about those issues last time. Now, as he continues on, the next one that he brings up is this issue of vigilant. Now, what's it mean to be vigilant? The idea there is to do what? To be on guard, to be watchful, to be temperate, to be able to be patient enough to be able to stand on the side and say, you know what? I see some of this stuff out here, and instead of just automatically reacting to it, what should we do? Be vigilant. Pay attention to it. Be mindful. Be watchful. There's something. Has anybody seen the conference up in Chicago this weekend? Anybody's watched those? Go over to Philippians real quick. There's something that I thought about this last night. Over in Philippians chapter 1. I'll be okay, everybody, just so you know. Does anybody else think it's 800 degrees in here? Sheesh. Okay, that's all that matters. Philippians chapter 1. Yeah, they're fine. So I'll just get over it. Philippians chapter 1. Notice this. Start here at verse 27. Philippians chapter 1, verse 27. Only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ, that whether I come and see you or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit. What's that issue there of standing fast? When you stand fast, the idea there is to do what? Take a stand and don't move. Right? So when he says this here, he says that ye stand fast, how? In one spirit. Is he talking about one particular person? He's talking to the church at Philippi. And he's saying, all of you together, notice he says that ye, that's that plural form of you, right? He's not saying one particular person. He says that ye stand fast in one spirit. You're going to take a stand and you're not going to be moved. He says what? With one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. There's an issue there again of these folks together are what? Striving together. Now, when you think of striving, that striving is not the same strife that he's talking about in 1 Timothy 3. Or the one he's talking about over in 2 Timothy, right? Here it's what? As a group what is a group supposed to be able to do? Strive together, which means what? You're going to take a stand and you're going to move forward. And you're going to move forward. And you're going to move forward. How? Together. You know the old saying, no one left behind type stuff? That's the idea. Why? For the faith of the gospel. Notice, and in nothing terrified by your adversaries, which is to them an evident token of perdition, but to you of salvation and that of God. Now, verse 29. He says, for unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for his sake. Now, pause there for a second. In verse 29, where he says, for unto you it is given. We've talked about this verse before. And John Verstegen says something last night, and it made me think of this idea of being vigilant, being on guard, being watchful, paying attention. Notice he says, for unto you it is given in the behalf of Christ. Here is a gift. The first gift is what? Not only to believe on him. Now stop for a second. Does that mean that you're to believe on him when you first got saved? Well, did you believe on him when you got saved? All right. But notice what he says. For unto you it is what? It's not that it was a past tense, but it's a what? It's an absolute current every single time. What are we to do is to do what? Believe on him in every aspect. When you talk about being vigilant and being on guard and being watchful, how are we to do that? By believing on him. Trusting him. When? All the time. It is given unto us in the behalf of Christ not only to believe on him. Every single moment of day. Every thought that we have. Every moment that we think. What should we do is trust in what he's doing.
So that's not just a doctrinal statement.
It's a life issue. Absolutely. And so then when we take a look at that, and it's not the Calvinistic lay back and say, well, whatever happens, happens, and I'm just going to trust what God does. That's not what it is. It's what? I know what God's doing today in the dispensation of the grace of God. He is forming the church, the body of Christ, and he's going to do something with us, not just out in the ages to come, but every single moment of every single day. And what are we to do? Believe on him. When? Always. How? By being vigilant. By being on guard, being watchful, paying attention to things, understanding what's going on, and making sure that we're able to do that. Go back to Isaiah chapter 56. I want you to see something back here. Isaiah chapter 56. Is it just me or is anybody else freezing in here? No. Yeah, it kicked on right before you went out, so it's all right. I probably am. No, I don't have a fever. Isaiah chapter 56. And I want you to notice something. I want you to notice something here. Isaiah chapter 56, we'll just start verse 1. All right. Thus saith the Lord, keep ye judgment and do justice. For my salvation is near to come, and my righteousness to be revealed. Blessed is the man that doeth this, and the son of man that layeth hold on it, that keepeth Sabbath from polluting it, and keepeth his hand from doing any evil. Neither let the son of the stranger that hath joined himself to the Lord speak, say, the Lord hath utterly separated me from his people. Neither let the eunuch say, behold, I am dry tree. I am a dry tree. For thus saith the Lord unto the eunuchs that keep my Sabbaths and choose the things that please me and take hold of my covenant, even unto them will I give in mine house and within my walls a place and a name better than the sons and of the daughters. I will give them an everlasting name that shall not be cut off. Notice, also the sons of the stranger that joined themselves to the Lord to serve him and to love the name of the Lord to be his servants, everyone that keepeth the Sabbath from polluting it and taketh hold of my covenant, even them will I bring to my holy mountain and make them joyful in my house of prayer. Their burnt offerings and their sacrifices shall be accepted upon mine altar, for mine house shall be called an house of prayer for all people. The Lord God, which gathereth the outcast of Israel, saith, yet will I gather others to him, beside those that are gathered unto him, all ye beasts of the field, come to devour, yea, all the beasts in the forests. Notice this. His watchmen are what? Blind. They are all ignorant. They are all dumb dogs. They cannot bark, sleeping, lying down, loving to slumber. Well, who would be the watchman? Here you have the spiritual leaders of the nation of Israel, and God says they're what? They're blind. Now, that shows up in Matthew, and we've talked about that, gone through Matthew. But here he's saying what? Who are to be the ones that are being vigilant and being on guard, the nation of Israel, the leaders there? What are they doing? They're blind. They're all ignorant. They're dumb as dogs. They cannot bark, sleeping, lying down, loving to slumber. Yea, they are greedy dogs which can never have enough. And they are shepherds that cannot understand. They all look to their own way, every one of his for his gain from his quarter. Come ye, say they, I will fetch wine. I will fill ourselves with strong drink, and tomorrow shall be as this day and much more abundant. The righteous perisheth, and no man layeth it to heart, and merciful men are taken away, none considering that the righteous is taken away from the evil to come. And he goes on down through here. But what do we see here? We see the religious leaders in the nation of Israel, they're to be what? They're to be watchmen. What are they doing? They're sleeping on the job. Now, when you go over to Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, specifically in Matthew, we've looked at this before. Here they are. They're sheep without a shepherd. Because the religious people are so far gone, they've not done what they're supposed to do. Now, one of the things that we have here for qualification for the bishop in the local assembly is to do what? To be a watchman. And as a watchman, what should we do? Not these things. But how often do watchmen or bishops of churches do exactly these things? How many of them are greedy dogs? I mean, you look at this, and you're just like, okay, that religious system, so what do we know about those people? Do they qualify? They don't. Back over in 1 Timothy chapter 3. We see the same type of issue over here. Notice he says, next one is what? We've got vigilant. The next one would be what? Sober. The idea of being sober is what? He's not talking about don't go drink, because he deals with that one later on. Because he says in verse 3, what? Not given to wine. What's interesting is you get down there to the deacons and he says what? Not given to much wine. So if you want to be a deacon, but not a bishop, like, well, I had a little bit with supper last night, so I guess I can't be a bishop, but I can be a deacon. Like, that one I can, you know, that's one thing. I've never, the smell of alcohol just makes me sick. I don't know how anybody does it, but they do it, so it is what it is. So y'all don't have to worry about that one with me. But I've told Delilah, I was like, if I did drink and I drank like I drink Dr. Pepper's, I'd be wasted all the time. So it's a good thing I didn't. But it's something else I need to get rid of. But Notice this idea of sober. He's not talking about that. He's talking about what? Being sober-minded. Thinking the proper way. We see the same thing. Go over to Titus. We see the same thing over over in Titus. He brings up this. He brings up the same issue with the folks there. Notice in Titus chapter 2. And this is one of those issues as well that pops up. In Titus chapter 2, he's talking to Titus here in verse 1. He says, "But speak thou the things which become sound doctrine." Now, as we've gone through that before, that issue isn't, it's not that it becomes sound doctrine. If you teach it enough and believe it enough, then it becomes sound doctrine. That becomes sound doctrine there is to do what? Make sure that the things that you speak match the doctrine that you believe, right? If you believe the thing, it's suitable. It matches the purpose of what God's doing with the sound doctrine. He's saying, so speak thou the things which become sound doctrine. That puts sound doctrine on display where people say, that's something different than what I've heard other places. Verse 2, what's the purpose of it? Here's the purpose. That. The aged men be sober. How is it that you're going to become sober-minded? By the way, do you have a sound mind because you're in Christ? And he's saying what? Go put that on. As a person that says, I desire the office of a bishop, he says, go put that on. He says what? Here's what you're to do, Titus, and by the way, Timothy's going to be the same way. Speak thou the things which become sound doctrine. Why? Here's the purpose, that the aged men be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, in patience. The aged women likewise, that they be in behavior as becometh holiness, not false accusers, not given to much wine, teachers of good things. Aged women, there you go. You got your wine as well, right? Verse 4, that they may teach the young women to be sober, to love their husbands, to love their children, to be discreet, chaste, keepers at home, good, obedient to their own husbands, that the word of God be not blasphemed. Young men likewise exhort to be sober-minded. It's that same issue. It's the what? Taking the mind. Go back over to 2 Timothy. Go over to 2 Timothy. There's a bunch of places we could go with this one, but 2 Timothy chapter 1. Trying to think. Bruce read one this morning. Get 1 Corinthians chapter 2. And we'll just notice some things here. Second Timothy chapter 1, verse 6. He says, "Wherefore I put thee in remembrance, that thou stir up the gift of God which is in thee by the putting on of my hands. For God hath not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and of what?" Do you have a sound mind already? God has given that to you. What he is saying is what? Take that sound mind that has been given to you and to do what with it? Put it on display. 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Verse 16. He says, "For who hath known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him?" It's a good question, right? Who hath known the mind of the Lord, that he may instruct him? Notice he doesn't stop there. What's he say? But we have. Is that something that he says, I'm going to give you? Or is it something that you have as a present possession? He says, we have the what? The mind of Christ. What he's saying is to do what? Take that information and go put it on display. Go use it. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. This idea of having this sober, to be sober, to be to have this sound mind. The idea there is what we're able to do is we can take the doctrine that we have, and if we want sound mind to be operation in our life, what do we need to do is find out that we have it and then find out how to use it and then go and allow God's word to produce that in us by faith. And what it's going to do is it's going to produce in us a desire to put aside our impulses and the things that we just want to do for ourselves. And instead, we're going to find a way that we're actually going to live the life that he wants us to live. Notice here in 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Start here at verse 1. He says, "Now I Paul myself beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of who?" You ever thought about that? He's beseeching him. That word beseech means to what? It's to beg, to ask. It's a grace word, right? Huh? And there are two fruits of the Spirit. He says, "Now I, Paul, myself beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of who? Of Christ. Not my own meekness, not my own gentleness, but the meekness and the gentleness of Christ, who in presence and base among you, but being absent and bold toward you. But I beseech you, why? That I may not be bold when I am present with that confidence, wherewith I think I have to be bold against some, which think of us as if we walked according to the flesh. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh." Notice the parentheses here. "For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds." Now, if you read verse 3 and then skip verse 4 and read verse 5 without that parenthetical, notice what he says. "For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh, casting down imaginations." Where are the imaginations? They're in your mind. What do? You have, what's the root word of imaginations is what? Image. You have an image in your mind, and what can we do with that image or those imaginations? He says to do what with those imaginations? Cast them down. That's us saying, this is what I see in my mind, and I know that's not who I am in Christ, and I want to think a different way. How do I do that? I recognize that that is not who I am as Christ, and I cast it down. Because if we don't know who we are in Christ, then we're not going to be able to do that. If we're always constantly trying to find some way to gain access, to gain privilege with God, or to gain something from God, and think that we've just not got anything and we got to do this, this, and this to get it, and God says what? "You already have access to my mind. It's in this book. And I've given you the capacity to make it known to you for a particular purpose." And it's to do what? Casting down imaginations. What happens is our knowledge will create an image. And that image is something that we have a choice. Do we make that image come to pass, or do we get rid of it? If you get rid of it, how are you thinking? Soberly. You have the capacity to do that today for yourself and every single day. How? By trusting on him. Who is it? Philippians says what? "He that hath begun a good work in you will perform it until the day of Christ." Who's doing the job? Who's going to help you cast down those imaginations? Who is it that's going to do what? "And every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God." Every time we think about something, every time we do that, it creates an image in our mind and it produces something that is exalted against the knowledge of God. And what can we do is what? He says, cast it down. And then notice, he says, "and bringing into captivity." Here's the issue, right? When you think soberly, what is it that we need to do is to take that thought and to do what? Bring every thought. He says, "and bringing into captivity every thought." To what? the obedience of Christ. How was Christ obedient? When you go over to Philippians 2, he brings up this issue and he says what? Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. Now, there's some weird stuff that I've heard taught about Philippians 2 that I grew up learning, and I was like, hey, that's pretty cool. And then I found out that's not what the verse is talking about at all. Here's what the verse is talking about. You have the ability to think the exact same way Christ would think in every situation of your life if you've got the Word of God stored up in you. Did Jesus Christ have the Word of God stored up in him? Every moment of his life, it was what? It is written. It is written. When he goes to the cross, he says what? It is written. In order for a verse to be fulfilled, he's hanging on the cross and he's going through the pain, the physical pain that he's going through. And he's thinking, there's a verse in the Old Testament that I got to make sure that comes to pass. And I'm going to say, I thirst. He's thinking about the scripture every moment of his life. He's obedient to God's word and God's will his entire life. And what Paul is bringing up here, he's saying, I beseech you by the meekness and gentleness of Christ. And if you want to live soberly minded, if you want to have that issue, if you want to have that sound mind, he says what? Take every thought, bring every thought into the captivity, bring every thought, bring it captivity to what? To the obedience of Christ. The obedience of Christ is what? There's a verse that goes with this issue in my life, and all I got to do is just trust the verse. Now, as we said before, that's the easiest hard thing you're ever going to do. Is it hard to do it? Yes. Is it easy to do it? Yes. Why is it hard? Think about this. What was the purpose? What was the problem with the law? Was the law perfect? Yes. Why was the law? What was wrong with the law? It was weak in the what? This flesh. Is God's word perfect? Is God's word powerful? Then what we know is the only time that it messes up is when it's our flesh that we're making the issue. I'll fix it. I'll take care of it. But what he's saying is what? If you live your life in complete and total obedience to this book, what's going to happen is you're going to think soberly. You're going to be able to access, hold your place there, and just Romans 5. Do you have access to the mind of Christ? That is something that you have as a personal present possession. Romans chapter 5, verse 1. He says, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Here's my point. Notice the verse 2. By whom also we have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand. Now, here's the issue. You're standing in grace. And as we've said before, what do we know about grace? Grace is sufficient for thee. If you're standing in grace, what does this verse tell us? That's where you're standing. How do you access that grace that you already stand in? By faith. Bruce read the verse this morning, 1 Thessalonians 2:13, right? The word of God will work effectually in you when you believe it. And if we, of course, in the context here of what we're dealing with the bishop, how should the bishop live that way? But didn't he also say the same thing for the aged men in the local assembly over there to Titus? He also say the same thing about the aged women and the young men and the young women. Is it possible for young people and old people to do exactly that, to live with the sober mind, the sound mind? How much easier is it to not live that way? And you take a look at this, he says what? By whom also we have access. Who is it that gives you access? is who? Jesus Christ. We have access by faith into this grace wherein we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. So we're back over here in 1 Timothy chapter 3. What we've seen so far about being blameless and the husband of one wife and vigilant and sober so far, the whole point of it is what? Putting on display who you are in Christ. The next one, 1 Timothy chapter 3. He says, a bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior. Well, that's that same thing that we just read over in Titus about. Go to Titus chapter 1. We didn't look at this one yet, but Titus chapter 1. Titus chapter 1, verse 6. He's ordaining elders in every city. Verse 6, he starts off, if any be blameless, the husband of one wife, having faithful children, not accused of riot or unruly, for a bishop must be blameless, as the steward of God, not self-willed, not soon angry, not given to wine, no striker, not given to filthy lucre, but are a lover of hospitality, a lover of good men, sober, just, holy, temperate, holding fast the faithful word as he hath been taught, that he may be able by sound doctrine both to exhort and to convince the gainsayers. What's the basis to exhort and convince the gainsayers? Sound doctrine. That's a whole nother, we could teach on that for a month and a half. Verse 10. For there are many unruly and vain talkers and deceivers, especially they of the circumcision, whose mouths must be stopped, who subvert whole houses, teaching things that they ought not for filthy lucre's sake. We looked at the verses prior to that, or the verses through here with this. Notice, drop down to verse 15. He says, unto the pure all things are pure, but unto them that are defiled and unbelieving is nothing pure. Don't you see that in our culture today? You see a culture that does what? They're defiled and unbelieving, and is anything pure to them? Nothing is. They can't look at, they can't say, well, this is good and this is not. Notice, but even their mind and conscience is defiled. When we think about the idea of sober-minded and have that sound mind, the next thing that should come about from that should be good behavior. Notice in verse 16. What happens to those that have their mind and their conscience defiled? They profess that they know God, but in works they deny Him, being abominable and disobedient, and unto every good work, what? What's it mean to be reprobate? It's worthless. It's functionally dead. We're talking about that a little bit ago in Romans chapter 8. That's a person that does what? That opposes themselves. What happens is, if you don't have sound mind or a sober mind, what's going to happen is you're not going to have good behavior. Good behavior then should be what? A result of that sound mind. Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8. Verses that we all know and love. For by grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Why? For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus unto good works, which God hath before ordained that we should walk in them. Well, stop and ask yourself again. That good work, who's performing it? Christ is. More often than not, what we need to do is to get out of the way and let the Word of God do the work. Instead of trying to put on a display, to say, look at me, look at what I've done. When I go through these verses, these are things that I try to remind myself all the time. Put on who you are in Christ. And he says what? A bishop then must be blameless, the husband of one wife, vigilant, sober, of good behavior. Now, that gets us to the last two in verse 2. Given to hospitality and apt to teach. And that's going to take more than just a few minutes to go through. So we'll pause there in verse 2. But we start seeing what we should notice is every one of these are really what? Products of God's Word working in and through the person. I'm never going to be blameless on my own. The only way I can be blameless is find out that I'm blameless and allow God's Word to produce that in me. By what? Allowing His Word to produce that. And if I think of something that's different, what do? I take it and I think about the obedience of Christ. How would Christ have lived in this particular way? How would He have responded here? 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 7 says what? For we walk by faith and not by sight. As we've said before, and this is a really good application of it. We've talked about before of pre-planning for problems. Start off with 2 Corinthians 5, 7. We walk by faith, not by sight. If we're going to live that way, what do we need to do? In order to live by faith, what do you have to have? You have to have this book. It's best if the book is in you. Not up here, but here. Because when the book is here and life happens, do you know what your automatic response should be or will be? What the verse says. I promise you, if you go through and you study and you take a look at how God's Word works, and you take a look at specific verses, you go through Romans, you go through Ephesians and all this stuff, what happens is if you go and you get those verses stored up in your soul, you're going to be shocked at how you respond to things from now on. And it's going to be, it gets to the point where it's second nature. As we said before, is when we react, that's an unplanned thing. But you can plan how to act a certain way. And what would be really fascinating and fantastic to be able to happen is if we all got in the same mindset that every time we reacted would be the way that we would have acted had we been able to have chosen to react that way. If that makes sense. That if you can think of a situation in life and say, in this situation of life, if this thing comes up, here's how I'm going to act. What would happen is, when you're going through life and that thing happens, your reaction should be that right there. Now, oftentimes what happens is we fall apart. And the reason why is because we end up trusting ourselves more than anything, and that's why we fall apart. Did Christ trust Himself? He trusted the book. He trusted the Father every step of the way. And if we could ever get to that point, when Luke writes about Paul, he talks about he turned the world upside down. You realize if every Grace Church was able to do what Paul would have done, do you know what we could do in this world today? We could turn it upside down. That's a better idea of, to look at the world that way. How are you going to turn the world upside down? How did Paul do it? He went and preached the word. He took this book into the people, evangelized, edified, set up local churches and gone there. We have an opportunity to do that. Somebody asked me a few weeks ago, said, sounds like you're recruiting some folks. I don't know if it's that, but I would love for all of us to be able to have that Philippians 2 mindset. We'd look for opportunities. We'd make opportunities to serve. That would be interesting to see. I'm seeing it now. And I'm really looking forward to seeing what happens off in the future. I thank the Lord for His work. I thank the Lord for His people. But as we're going through these, remind yourself, these are all things that you already have. We may not be walking in them by faith, but we have them. We have access to them.